privilege of coming to church. We love our country. We love the freedoms of religion. We are free to come here and without fear of persecution or arrest. We give you the thanks for that. We're thankful for our Bibles, that when we come to church, we can have our Bibles in our hands and Lord, look at them as we walk through passages of Scripture. Thank you, Father, for Pastor Matt, Jill, and the family, their diligence of serving you in Liberty Baptist Church, and the church 100% behind them. The work of the Lord goes on, and we are privileged to be a part of that from time to time. So again, Lord, we ask that our minds would be focused on the Word of God this morning, that the cares of this world would not drown out the voice of the Spirit of God as He speaks to us. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. A little boy, upon returning from his first day in kindergarten, was asked by his mother what he learned. His reply was, "We learn to play with kids we don't like." The illustration goes on, probably this is one of the most significant lessons this child will ever learn. And how true is that? Would it not be advisable for some of us believers to return to kindergarten? We have yet to learn this invaluable lessons of how to love those we don't even like. Is that what 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 16 is talking about, which your pastor graciously asked if I would continue on his study? Let's go to 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 16. He wanted to finish the epistle of 1 John this year, and he asked if I would go ahead and continue on through this for him. And I don't mind building upon another man's foundation at all. I enjoy that. I enjoy having someone assign the text for me. Then I know what can be done. And so as we walk through 1 John, I just titled the message, "Let's Go Back to Kindergarten." Why? Because John is talking about in 1 John, which you already know, it's not the first opportunity John has brought up in here. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, "Beloved, let us love one another." Well, let's go back to kindergarten today then. Let us love one another. For love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And this was manifested in the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwells in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us his Spirit, and we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelt in us dwelt in God, and God in him." Let's go back to kindergarten for a while today. Learn about the love of God and how we can love one another. And it's really elementary. Love God and love one another. That's really elementary. It's very elementary, spiritually speaking, for us to love God and love one another. And it's so elementary that we're going to look at it this way. The elementary part is you love one another. We love one another. Well, we can say, yeah, we do that well. Good. Let's see how it's really done in the Scriptures. It's elementary, and man, it's so elementary. Point number one, how do you love one another is the question. How do we love one another? Well, just hang around with God the Father. Just hang around with God the Father. You know what you're going to learn? Tenderness. the tenderness of God the Father. The Apostle John, a little bit of review here, probably from what your pastor has told you about the Apostle John. John was raised learning about God. He was raised in a culture. He was raised in a family. He was raised learning about God. And he learned about the tenderness of God just by learning about how God treated Adam and Eve. He learned about how God treated Noah and his family during the flood, and Moses and Israel at the Red Sea, and the list goes on and on and on. He learned that. He learned about God. John also not only learned about God, but John bought into the message from John the Baptist of repentance and believing in the Messiah that was coming. Perhaps he even heard him say, "Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." He bought right into that. Why? Because he'd already learned about God's tenderness. And all of a sudden we see God manifest in his tenderness. "Behold, the Lamb of God." And he bought into the message of John the Baptist. John was one of the first converts of Jesus Christ when Jesus said, "Come, follow me. And I shall make you fishers of men." And John was at the transfiguration of Jesus Christ. When he heard the tender love of God the Father toward the man, Christ Jesus. "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." Did that leave a mark on John? That tender love of the Father, that leave a mark on John? Absolutely. Jesus saw that. Jesus saw that in the Apostle John. Remember when Jesus Christ was hanging on the cross? He looked down and looked at his mother and he says, "Behold thy son." And then he looked over here. They probably weren't this far apart. And he looked down at the Apostle John and says, "Behold thy mother." I'm not sure there's a more tender scene in the Bible than that one right there. Here's Jesus Christ on the cross, dying for the sins of the world. And he's thinking about his mother. "Behold thy mother." He saw so much love in the Apostle John and the tenderness and the tender heart of the Apostle John. He says, I'm gonna entrust my mother to this man. So I guess it's not any surprise that verse 7 starts out with "beloved." Same word that the Father used. Beloved. Term of endearment. And they both meant it. The Father meant it, and so did the Apostle John. Why? Because he'd been touched. He'd been hanging around with God the Father, and he'd been touched by the tenderness of God the Father, and he meant it. We have a lady friend from our previous ministry that calls me every once in a while, and she's kind of my mother. She adopted me as her son, kind of like type thing, and then it was just fine with me. And she always asks, she calls, she's talked for quite a while, and she goes, "Did you tell your wife you love her today?" Always the mom, you know. The tender love. John says in verse 7, "Beloved, let us. He's including him. He wasn't like a grumpy old man barking out orders to the younger generation. No, he says, "Beloved, let us," including himself in there. He wasn't like a grumpy old man. It's more like a grandpa's prayer at the Christmas meal. That tenderness coming out in John's pen and in his heart. "Let us," includes himself with that. "Let us love one another." Let us love one another. Well, what is this love thing? I'm sure Pastor has given you several definitions. I have one too. F.F. Bruce gives it, and I believe this is very accurate, at least for what I was taught through the years. Love involves a consuming passion for the well-being of others. A consuming passion for the well-being of others. Well, how do we do that? How do we have that that consuming passion for the well-being of somebody else? How do we have that? I'll give you a short answer. Of. Verse 7 says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God." That little two-letter preposition, of, carries it with the idea of origin. Origin. Where does that love that we need to love one another, where does it originate from? Where does it come from? The Lord is exit out of. Where does it come from? It comes from the Father. It comes from God, is love of God. And that's exactly the source of all love. A matter of fact, all love comes from God. And you know as well as I do, in your Bible, there are three different words for love. There's agape, there's storge, and there's phileo. Agape is God's love. Storge is family love between a husband and a wife. Phileo is brotherly love, where we get Philadelphia. Phileo, storge, agape. This is agape here. And it all comes from God. All love comes from God. And it's always toward people. God's love is always toward people. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world." He wasn't talking about Iowa. He wasn't talking about this ball of mud we call the earth. He was talking about people. God's love is always toward people. He wasn't talking about animals. He wasn't talking about anything else. God's love is always toward people. And that's what we are to have our loves for. And everyone that loves agape, everyone that loves is born of, there's our little word again, of, originate, born of God. Well, what does that mean? You know what that means. He's born again. How were you born again? Did you do something to be born again? Absolutely not. It's impossible for you to do that, myself as well. We were all born again because it originated from God. As a matter of fact, it's all carried out by God too. And everyone that loves is born of God, spiritually born again, originating from God. God adopting us into his family, Christ adopting us into his family, Ephesians chapter 1. And knows God, not knows about God. We see the terminology here, hidden in the terminology. We see the Apostle John was raised learning about God. And he knew God on the sense where the Old Testament, remember when John was being raised, that was Old Testament. When John was writing even his gospel, that was not necessarily Old Testament, but it was before the cross. It was before Christ and the cross, so we have to keep that distinct. So he had an understanding of God, but then when he was born again, he had a newer understanding and a better understanding. So he not only knew about God, but now he knows God in a very close, spiritual, intimate, ongoing fellowship with God. Hallelujah. Amen. I love my wife more than anybody on the planet. Okay? There. I just, now my mother, adoptive mother, can ask me if I love my, said I love, yes, I do. I love her more than anybody on the planet. And you know what keeps that love going and growing? We hang around together. We hang around together all the time. I love the ministry for many reasons, but one of the reasons was I was pretty much with her 24 hours a day. You know, some days that wasn't enough. It just wasn't enough. That's what love is. We just want to hang around with one another. And so this is really very elementary, and we need to go back to kindergarten every once in a while to learn that tender love of God the Father. We just need to hang around with the Father. Just hang around the Father more. Wait, there's more. Number two, hang around with God the Son. You're going to learn then tough love. Tough love. Hang around with God the Father, you're going to learn about his tender love, and you're going to pick up on that, his tender love. And you hang around God the Son, you're going to pick up on tough love. The Apostle John wasn't just an old, cuddly, teddy bear pushover type guy. He wasn't only just that. And he was very tender, loving. He was an apostle of love, but he had his, let's call him in those sons of thunder moments. John had those moments too. Tough love. Tough love requires tough talk. Taking this into context, I'm not talking the tough talk of the world. You have no business at all talking like that. I don't either. But the tough love in the scriptures, and the tough love has tough talk. My dad had tough talk when he needed to have tough talk with me. He loved me. There was no doubt in my mind that he loved me. But sometimes I did something that was probably wasn't the smartest thing to do. And matter of fact, it was misbehaving or something. And my dad, all of a sudden's voice would have tough talk to it. Tough love, but it was tough talk too. And there was no sugarcoating when he was talking. There was no doubt in my mind what was had better change, or something was not going to happen that's going to be fun. That's tough talk. That requires tough talk. Tough love requires tough talk. Well, the Apostle John, look in verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. That's kind of tough. That's kind of tough talk. You're not loving one another. You don't know God. That's what he's saying to the people here. Tough talk. Let me do a little explanation here too, because as the verses goes on, it wasn't that the absence of love was the absence of being born of God or born again. Absence of love shows that a person who does not love does not have intimate fellowship with, no, God. It does not necessarily show that he was never born of God. Because God is light, those who abide in him walk in his light. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. Because God is righteous, those who abide in him practice righteousness. 1 John chapter 2, verse 29. Just so, God is love, and those who abide in him manifest his loving character. Thomas Constable said that. So we have to be careful, which this verse has been misconstrued too many times. He that loves God knoweth not God, or loveth not God knoweth not. So the idea isn't that a person is not born again if they're not loving one another as believers. The idea is they're out of fellowship with God, the Son. They don't know him. They're not in that loving relationship, that fellowshipping part of that. And that's John talking pretty tough there. You kind of wonder, where did John learn the importance of tough love with tough talk? I'll tell you exactly where he learned it. Hanging around with Jesus. Hanging around with Jesus Christ when he was here on earth, and since then as well. He testified, he says in the following verses, he witnessed Jesus' tough talk to the disciples. Oh, you have little faith. Why did you doubt? Now you'd put that to you, and if I said to someone in here, you don't have any faith. Your faith is, that's pretty tough. And that's what the tough talk Jesus is saying to his disciples. Why? He loved them. And he wanted their faith to grow. As Jesus was kind of tough talking to his disciples, he also got pretty tough talking to the religious leaders. Read Matthew chapter 23. You're going to find 8 times in there. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites! I don't know if he raised his voice. I had a lady ask me recently, did Jesus shout? I go, I don't know. I have a hard time hearing Jesus shout, but I'm not going to cast that out either, because even if he did it righteously. But he got right after those religious leaders. Tough talk them, and even that malicious crowd that came up on him in the garden, that malicious crowd that came up there, and he spoke to them, and what happened to them? They fell over backwards. That's pretty tough. But that's the tough talk that is enveloped by tough love. Well, tough talk, tough action comes from tough love. That requires tough action. Verse 9. And this was manifest to the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Verse 10. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Verse 14. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Here's some tough questions. How tough was it for Jesus Christ to leave the only home that he'd ever known? Some of us have had to do that. I mean, most of us here have had to do that, to leave the only home that we have ever known. That's pretty tough, wasn't it? How tough was it for Jesus to come knowing what he had to do that we could live through him now and forever? How tough was it for Jesus to face the one who had just betrayed him and yet still called Judas Iscariot friend? Tough love. It's tough action. How tough was it for Jesus to hang from the cross? Father, in prayer, Father, forgive them, for they How tough was it for Jesus to give up the ghost? He didn't just pass away, sorry. He gave up the ghost. He gave up his life to be the sacrifice that satisfies, the propitiation for you, sinner, for me, sinner. Not only for us, as 1 John said in chapter 2, but for the sins of the whole world. You know, there are a lot of people in this world you don't like. And there are a lot of people in this world I don't like. You know what? Jesus loved them. You have to too then. And how can we do that? You hang around with Jesus. How hard was that for him to do that? One gentleman said, since no one in all humanity is beyond the reach of our Savior's sacrificial death, no brother or sister should be on our sacrificial love. Dodd said that is the gentleman's name. That requires tough action for us. We saw Jesus, and all of a sudden John's word echoed the hallways of time. Behold, what manner of love is this? The Father should send the Son. Requires a tough person. Yep. It requires tough talk and tough action, but it requires a tough person. Courage. Courage is defined as being scared to death but saddling up anyway. That's what Jesus did. He totally was aware that he would be verbally, socially, emotionally, spiritually abused, but he saddled up anyway. That is a tough person to do that. How in the world could he do that? God is love. And since Jesus is God, it was in his character, his nature to do that, to have that consuming passion for the well-being of others. The church has no more effective way to testify to the world about the saviorhood of Jesus Christ than by the redisplay of the Savior's love in the fellowship of his disciples. Hang around with God the Father. You'll be surprised how tender your love can become. Hang around with God the Son. You'll be surprised how tough your love can be. Wait, there's more. Triple that. The Father's love, the Son's love, with God the Spirit's love, and his tenacity. Tenacity, the tenaciousness of love is seen in the Spirit's tenacity is defined as holding persistently to retain, to keep. We see that in verses 11 through 16 in the word dwell. Verse 11, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelt in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he is in us, because he hath given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelt in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love of God that God has. God is love, and he that dwells in love dwells in God, and God in him. The tenacity, the tenaciousness of Jesus, of the Holy Spirit, that stick-to-itiveness, that retaining. We have a kids' club, children's club on Wednesday night at our church in Green, and my wife teaches in that. I don't teach. I don't teach. I go along. I don't teach there. What do I go along for 2 hours? What do I do for 2 hours? I'll tell you what I do. I'm the armed guard. Literally. I am the armed guard. I sit outside the church in a car and observe everybody that goes into that church. And as I sit out there, I am the armed guard. I'm guarding. I have two responsibilities, and two of the responsibilities, number one is to the people in that building. My responsibility is to guard those that are in that building. She's one. My pastor is one. My pastor's wife is another one. My pastor's family is another. And Rick and Christy Yotter, a couple that are in there serving the Lord. Twyla Ring is in there. Jane is in there. And Kathy is in there. And Jessica and her girls are in there. And there's a whole bunch of kids in there. And some of those kids need to hear Jesus Christ as Savior. They need him as Savior. So my responsibility is, one, is to guard the people in that church. And the other responsibility, and the reason I do that is not only because of who's in that building, but who's in me. And as I sit out there, and I get to use my sanctified imagination. We're going to hear some about this subject pretty soon here. But as I sit out there, I literally pray that the Holy Spirit, I'll get my hand down. I'm trying not to get charismatic here. We're in a Baptist church, and we got to be careful. I literally sit out there and pray that God, the Holy Spirit, would work in the hearts of everyone in that church. Not only the kids that are unsaved, but the kids that are saved, and the teachers as they have the opportunity to expound upon the Word of God and plant that precious seed into their hearts and minds and lives. That's the kind of guard duty I like. Why? Because it's of God. here of God. Well, we need tenacious love as an everyday practice. Verse 9 says that we might live through him, through Jesus Christ. We need that day by day and with each passing moment, everyday practices in our lives, what we do, what we say, what we think. We need that love. We need that tenacious love as an ongoing process. Verse 12 says, his love is perfected in us. That's an ongoing process. The Spirit of God's love is a perfecting in us. It's working in us. It's helping us to grow to be more like Jesus Christ. It's a present passive indicative, which simply means it's presently going on, and it's passive. It means it's being done by someone else. And it's just going on and on and on. And we need the tenacious love from an indwelling person. You notice all these things are wrapped around a person. God the Father is a person. God the Son is a person. God the Spirit is a person. They're all God. One in essence, three in persons. Verse 13, the indwelling person given us his Spirit. Why? Reproduction. Fruit of the Spirit reproduces in us. He reproduces in us. The first one is love. That indwelling person, teacher, comforter, guide, guard, influencer, that Holy Spirit within us, inside of us. You know as well as I do that if a teacher leaves the room, we're talking chaos. And the longer that teacher leaves the room, we're talking major chaos. But if the teacher retains his tenacious and staying in the room, good things happen. And that's why we have the forever indwelling Holy Spirit within us. And we're so glad that he does. Because if we do not have him working in us, then that love of the Spirit is going to be chaotic. It's going to be turned into nothing more than just, well, I love my family and I love my brothers and the Lord. The love of God, that agape love in us. The love of God displayed in his people is the strongest defense that God has in the world. Strongest apologetic is a word that God has in the world, that God really exists in the world. And we get to manifest that like he manifested that to us. In an everyday, ongoing, indwelling work of the Holy Spirit. I have a hard time preaching without quoting Warren Wiersbe someplace. He said this, too much witnessing today is a mere mouthing of words. People need an expression of love with those words. The bottom line to love one another is really elementary. It's really elementary. Hang around with God the Father, you'll learn that tender love. Hang around with God the Son, you'll learn that tough love. Hang around with God the Spirit, you'll learn the tenacious love. And as we learn, they will incorporate that into our very spiritual lives and beings, and then that will be coming out in our everyday life towards the brothers and sisters in Christ, and yea, even to the lost. Well, maybe hang around with doesn't set well with you. That's okay. We'll let our teacher use the words of the Apostle John in his letters. In 1 John 1:3 says, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his son, Jesus Christ, and according to verse 8 of chapter 4, given us of the Spirit. Here's our challenge then. Number one challenge is, do you even know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Because if you don't, all this is naught. This letter was written to believers, to encourage believers to love one another. So first and foremost, you need to come to Christ as your personal Savior. Not only so you'll understand the Bible, so you won't go to hell. That's just as real as any place else. And so if you need some counsel and understanding on that, I'm very glad to help you. The majority of people in this room will too, Pastor Gary as well. So first and foremost, you need to know Jesus Christ as your Savior because you need to be born of God. You need to know about God, yes, but you need to be born of God. As John learned from, for example, John the Baptist, as John the Baptist was preaching, he says, repent and repentance. Change your mind about yourself. Change your mind about the religious thinking that you have about God and you need to change. And believe in the Messiah that is coming. Well, he already came. So the rest of us then, the message is, when we struggle with loving one another, we need to go back to kindergarten then. Let's go back to kindergarten, spiritually speaking. Because more than likely, when we do not have love for one another, we are out of fellowship with the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. What we need to do then, in our own heart of hearts, is get back in fellowship. Start hanging around with God. Father, the question could be asked, what did we learn today? We learn that we need to play with kids we don't even like. More importantly, we need to learn to love one another, whether we like them or not. Because once we start doing that, inevitably, we will really start to like them. Because they are one of us, because they are one of yours. Thank you for the challenge from the Word of God today. Thank you for these people. They love one another. We love one another, but we can always do better. Thank you for taking us to school today. And all God's people said, amen.